Hello, welcome to this lecture. We talked about a simple in vitro experiment of a protein binding onto DNA and predicting the probability of seeing the bound state or predicting what one would see experimentally. So we were talking about a system where you have a DNA and you had a protein. And we said that we cannot tell where the protein would be. The protein could diffuse around anywhere. In principle, DNA also could diffuse around. But in the last example, we said that we just assume DNA is in the middle and the protein can diffuse around anywhere. And we asked the question, how likely that you will find protein and DNA nearby bound? So this was the question we asked. So we wanted to clarify some things. First thing is, let us define the state once more. So state is basically position of all molecules. So in this simple case we discuss, it is the position of DNA and protein. We assume DNA is always the center. It essentially turns out to be the state is equal to position of protein molecule. The protein molecule could be at different locations. And we divided the divided this into 9 boxes for simplicity. And we wrote down that the probability of seeing the system in state S is A times e power minus energy of the state divided by KBT. Let us first talk about the name. So this is known as the Boltzmann distribution. So this is named after famous scientist Boltzmann. So this is Boltzmann distribution. So that is the name of this probability distribution. Now, we said briefly in the lecture that this assumes that you have a big system and essentially water molecules with ions and salt defining the temperature of the system. So the number of water molecules and ion molecules are much larger than the biomolecules that we are considering, and we will consider a few biomolecules. And if we have a, when we say the system, here we mean the biomolecules. Biomolecules of our interest. So the biomolecules of our interest is what we call a system. Everything else together we would call thermal bath. Why are we calling it? Because everything else other than the biomolecules of our interest together essentially for this particular purpose defines the temperature. They fix the temperature T, and given the temperature we are going to say how likely to find the system at a particular state S, which has a particular configuration of molecules, that is particular position of proteins, and in principle DNA could be too. Now, so that is the third point I wanted to make. How do we count the state? So how do we count the states? So in the previous lecture, for simplicity, we took 9 states. But ideally, it is not 9. There are many possible arrangements. So if I have a molecule of a particular size, let us say I have a protein molecule which has size of 1 nanometer, at least I can think of the volume divided by 4 by 3 pi a cube, which is the volume of the protein. If I have a protein of radius a and I am saying 4 by 3 pi a cube is the volume of the protein, I can think of, so let us say this is the volume of the beaker or test tube that I have. So let us say I know the volume of the whole beaker and 4 by 3 a cube. If the folded protein has a particular radius a, then this is the volume of my protein, and I can think of this many different positions possible, right? Easily, right? So positions of positions possible for protein. This I can easily think of. In principle, quantum mechanics tells me that the smallest length possible is something called the Planck length. It is related to the Planck's constant h. So in principle, I can have the volume of the beaker divided by the Planck length cube. This many states are in principle possible. But for our purpose, at least we can consider this many states. So ideally, one has to sum, one has to compute all possible states. For the practical purpose of actually computing quantities accurately, one has to at least compute this many. Ideally, one can have the volume of the beaker divided by the Planck length cube. This many states, this many positions would be possible inside the beaker. So that defines the number of states, right? Number of states has to be proportional to the volume of the beaker. So that tells you how many states are possible, and that many states P1, P2, P3, P4 up to this state, let us say call this n possible states, ns. So I have ns possible states. So the third thing I want to talk about is A. So we said A is actually computed by arguing that the total probability has to be 1. So in other words, sum over S from 1 to how many possible states? Let us say there are ns possible states, then sum over total probability has to be 1. By demanding this, one can compute A. In other words, A times sum over S equal to 1 to ns e power minus es divided by kbt is 1. For simplicity, we would use a notation that 1 over kbt as beta. So then I would write this as e power minus beta times s. So beta, I would use a shorthand notation that 1 over kbt is beta. So then this would be e power minus beta times kbt. So this tells me that A times sum over S e power minus beta S is equal to 1. A is nothing but inverse of this, right? So this implies, let me write that here, this implies that A is 1 over sum over S e power minus beta S, and this S sum runs from 1 to ns. Often this quantity at the denominator is called a partition function. So this can be often written as, this is written as 1 over z, where z is sum over s 1 to ns e power minus beta s. So this is a very useful quantity in statistical thermodynamics, and this quantity has a name called partition function. So as of now, so partition function is essentially a normalization constant, therefore by itself does not have any physical meaning, but we are going to see that this is going to be very useful to compute free energy. Let me just say that the logarithm of this is related to free energy, and we are going to explain this a little bit more in detail later. Another important point that I want to make is that the Boltzmann distribution, the P of S, is an equilibrium distribution. So this happens in thermal equilibrium. let us define the equilibrium in this particular way. So you have an isolated system. So this system is isolated from outside. So this is, let us say, it's isolated, and you have this DNA and this protein molecule, and you have water and iron molecules and salt, right? So here you have water, salt, etc. at some temperature T. And we said once that you can define equilibrium as the state that you would see after a very long time. If you leave this protein and DNA for a very long time and then you observe the states, after a very long time. So how long is very long? It is larger than all times involved for binding, dissociation, etc. So the time that you observe has to be much, much larger than all the binding rate, binding or dissociation time scales. So let us say the binding time scale, the rate of binding is, let us say, 1 per minute, and the dissociation is, let's say, 1 per 10 minutes, then the longest time is 10 minutes. So you look at the system much longer than 10 minutes, like many hours. A simple definition of equilibrium state is the state that happens after a very long time. And if you have an isolated system at a particular temperature T, you wait long enough, the system would reach equilibrium. And at equilibrium, you would see the protein in different positions. Sometimes you will see them bound, sometimes you would see them dissociated, sometime that you would see the protein diffusing and moving around. So all of these states can be captured, and all of those states have some probability, and that's what we said as e power minus beta this divided by z. So if I know the energy of each of those states, I can compute the probability. So another thing I wanted to say is about temperature. So the temperature here in this PS appear in beta, which is e power minus ES by KB T divided by Z. So if I increase the temperature, let us say the temperature goes to infinity, so 1 by infinity would be 0 and e power 0 would be 1, and then it would be 1 by z. So if the temperature goes to infinity, PS would be 1 by z. That means all states would be equally likely. So temperature has a role here. I want you to think about this. At higher temperature, what happens to the probability, and how does the temperature affect the states of the system? It's worth thinking about it. Do think about this. Maybe you can plot this as a function of temperature, or you can play around this with this and understand how the temperature would affect this system. I want to define a few things. So let me define something called an ensemble. So you can imagine such in vitro system. I can make an in vitro system like this, and you can make an in vitro system like this. Each of you can make an in vitro system like this. So you can make many copies of this in vitro system, and each of them, if they are at a particular temperature T and it has a particular, in this case, let us say it has a particular volume V, and let's say it has a particular number of molecules. So there is number of protein molecules or number of DNA molecules, they are too fixed. If I specify the temperature, if I specify the volume of the beaker, and if I specify the number of DNA and protein molecules in this, you can make a similar system. Each of you can make copies of similar systems. So, you can imagine making many copies of similar systems, right? So, many copies, many similar copies having same TV and N in this particular case. So, let us say TV and N in this particular case. So, this, if it's such many copies, are called ensemble. So, if I fix TV and N, they help, it is a particular ensemble, let us call it TVN ensemble, NVT ensemble. So, let us call this NVT ensemble. That is, I am going to make many copies of the system having a particular N, a particular V, and a particular T. You can imagine doing this, and in such a system, I can compute probabilities, I can compute each of this. So, let us say make the system at, let us say, morning 10 a.m. and then you keep the system for a few days, and then you come back after 2 days, then exactly at 10 a.m. all of us can measure the position of the DNA and protein. And you can ask the question, if there are 100 of us, out of this 100 systems, how many systems had, how many of the our systems had protein and DNA bound? And the answer would be given by this. So, I just want you to understand this once more carefully. I can make many copies of this system having the same temperature, same volume, and same number of biomolecules, and we keep the system for a period so that the system reaches equilibrium. All of our systems, all of our beakers, biomolecules are in equilibrium, in thermal equilibrium. And then we ask the question that at a particular time, let us say on a particular date at a particular time, all of us at the same time measure, or let us say we can take a magical photograph which would tell us the position of protein and DNA molecules, and we can ask how many of you find the protein bound to the DNA, or what state do you find, and the state that you find would be exactly this distribution. So, that is another way of understanding the Boltzmann distribution. So, the meaning of this P of S is the claim is that if you have many such copies, if you have 1000 such copies or 100 such copies, what fraction of them would find in the bound state, what fraction of them would be in various states, will be given by this formula. So, this is another important point for us to understand. Another point I want to make, in the previous thing, for simplicity, we had divided into 9 boxes. So, we had divided this into actually 9 separate boxes, and the DNA was in the middle box. So, this was DNA, and this was protein. And we said that, so we named it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We said that this is not just the 9 states. We said for this 9 states are for simplicity. Ideally, the state would be, number of states would be proportional to the volume. The bigger the beaker, there are so many states possible. And for simplicity, let us assume 9 states. Out of these 9 states, we said there is only one state which is bound possible when both DNA and protein are in this state 5. Let us call a name for these 9 states. So, these 9 states are called microstates. So, these 9 states I would call a name microstates, but there is another state which I have defined, which is, let us say, the bound state or dissociated state. So, there were, in, when it is bound, there is only one configuration, one microstate, but when the protein was in any other A states, they were unbound, unbound state. So here also I used the word state, but this unbound state has a different, I would call this as a macro state. This unbound state has many microstates. So a bunch of microstates together. Whenever all states where protein and DNA are far away, all of them together I would call it a macro state. So one macro state will have many microstates. And this macro state, one such macro state is the unbound state. Bound state is also a macro state. So in this simple example, we said, let us assume that only in the fifth box they would be bound. But you can think of a generalization of this, where DNA can also diffuse, protein also can diffuse. So whenever protein and DNA in the same box, you would call that bound. So there are in that example, there could be many bound states possible, and there would be many unbound state possible. Imagine both DNA and protein diffusing throughout this beaker. You would find many states, many more states than 9, and you can count those states. Wherever DNA and protein are not in the same location, if they are not nearby, you would call this unbound. And if protein and DNA are nearby, let's call it bound. Then you can think of many microstates, many arrangements where protein and DNA are not bound, and many arrangements when protein and DNA are bound. So bound and unbound. So bound state or unbound or dissociated state . These are macro states. So the name is macro state, and the position of the molecules decides the micro state. So there is a difference between micro state and macro state. Micro states is defined by, if you have a particular position for protein and DNA, that is a micro state. So let me write that once more. Micro state . If I specify a particular position, let us say X, and of the protein, and if I specify the position of the DNA, this gives me one microstate. And you can have another position of protein, another position of DNA, that could be another microstate, right? So in this particular example that we said, the DNA was always at 5, so you could have 1, 5, you could have 2, 5, 3, 5, and so on and so forth up to 9, 5. So there were 9 microstates we wrote down. If you allow also the DNA to diffuse, you could think of 1, 1, 1, 2. There are many possible states you can think of. But in this example that we discussed last time, there were 9 microstates specified by position of DNA and position of protein. We assume that the position of DNA is always in the fifth box, but position of protein could be in any of these 9 boxes. Let me just write those 9 states once more. Protein can be in state box 1, DNA is always in the fifth box. So protein can be in 1st, 2nd, 3rd, protein can be in the 4th box, both can be in the 5th box, 6, protein can be in the 6th, protein can be in the 7th, 8th or 9th, right? I hope you understood this. So this is protein being here, or in any of these boxes. That's what specified here. In only when both are in 5, this macro state in this particular, this is the bound state, and all other states are dissociated states. So the macro dissociated macro state has 8 different microstates, and this became important when we computed the total probability of the dissociated state. All of this contributed, and this idea is going to be important. So in the dissociated macro state, there are 8 microstates. Think about this. How many microstates are there in a particular macrostate? In the dissociated macrostate, there are 8 microstates. This idea is going to be important. We can also think about how many microstates are there of a particular energy. So in this case, again, the energy was only when it's bound. So all of these microstates had zero energy. This microstate alone had a particular energy epsilon. So we are going to also think about number of microstates having a particular energy E. And we are going to use this idea to define entropy in the coming lectures. So we will use this idea. Now that we have learned how to compute probability of a particular microstate or a particular state, let us define some quantity which many of you have heard of called the internal energy. So let us define this quantity called internal energy. Let us just remind what we learned. We learned that probability of any particular microstate is given by energy of that, if I know the energy of that microstate, calculate EI by KBT, find exponential minus of EI by KBT, divided by some normalization constant Z, which we also earlier wrote it as A e power minus beta EI. A is nothing but 1 over Z. And beta is, so A is 1 over Z and beta is 1 over KBT. Let us also take the simple example of DNA and protein that we took. We defined simple 9 states. We said that there's DNA in the middle box and then protein in some other box. So the protein could be in any one of the 9 boxes. And we can define probability of each of these 9 boxes. And we saw that the energy of this interaction between protein and DNA is 0 if protein in any one of the state. So E1, E2, E3, E4, E6, E7, E8, all of this 0. And E5 alone was minus 1 KBT at room temperature. This was something that we saw. And correspondingly, the probability of the first state and second state and so on and so forth, P1, P2, etc., everything except P3, P4, P6, P7, P8, P9, all was this A, which is 1 over Z. And if I substitute these values, you will see that P5 alone was A e power 1 and all other was A. This is something we saw. And if we substitute, we can find that A is 0.093. This is something that we found. So given the probabilities and energies, let us define internal energy. So internal energy is a thermodynamic quantity, and all thermodynamic quantities are average quantities. So internal energy is nothing but the average energy. So internal energy, let me write E bar, is nothing but the average energy of the system. How do we calculate average energy of the system? Any average, so if you have any quantity x, if I want to calculate average of that x, is the way to do that is multiply that quantity with the probability and sum over 1 to all possible states ns. So here we have 9 states and we want to compute the energy average. So what I do, I multiply the energy of the E state with the corresponding probability of the state and sum. If I do that, I would get the average energy. So internal energy is nothing but EIPI sum. The average energy is defined as the internal energy. We can compute the internal average energy of this particular system. So let us look at E1, E2, E3, all of those are 0. So if I expand this for this 9 state, what would I get? I would get the average energy is equal to E1 P1 plus E2 P2 plus dot 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 E5 P5 plus dot 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 E9 P9. So the average energy is E1 P1 plus E2 P2 plus dot 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 E9 P9. Only value of E is non-zero is E5, which is minus 1. So you have a minus 1 times the probability of the fifth state. Everything else is 0. So if E average here will turn out to be E5, which is minus 1 KBTR, minus 1 KBTR times the probability of the fifth state, which is AE. So AE will turn out to be 0.093 and E is 2.72. So this will turn out to be 254 or approximately 0.254. Approximately 0.254. So then this will turn out to be minus 1 times 0.254 KBTR, which is KBT times the room temperature, KB times the room temperature, which will turn out to be 4 into 10 power minus 21 joule. So basically it is minus 0.254 times 4 into 10 power minus 21 joule. That is going to be the average energy of this system. The system would be in any of these states, sometime here, and so on and so forth. When it is here, it has an energy of minus 1 KBTR. But since it is exploring all states, the average energy is going to be smaller than this. So the average energy of this, let me write, the average energy of this E bar is minus 0.254 KBT at room temperature. This is minus 0.254 times 4 into 10 power minus 21 joule approximately. This would approximately 1 by 4 KBTR or approximately 10 power minus 21 joule. This is going to be the average energy of the system. So this is the way to define internal energy. With this, we'll stop for today and continue in the next lecture. Thank you.